I would like to welcome all attendees of this EFLM webinar. My name is Daniel Reidel. I am the chair of EFLM workgroup for distance education and e-learning, and I am happy to be a moderator of this session. Today we have a great opportunity to have Anna Merino here. She is a senior consultant of cytology unit of hemotherapy and hemostasis department in hospital clinic in Barcelona. Her main research interests are morphology and identification of hematopoietic progenitor cells using flow cytometry, external quality programs in peripheral blood smear, and automatic classification of abnormal peripheral blood cells. She has written two monographies and more than 80 articles in scientific journals with H index 17. She's also a corresponding member of our workgroup, EFLM workgroup for distance education and e-learning. Today's presentation is unique because it is the first time that the main topic is an interesting case file presentation. And I hope that it will be an inspiration for other EFLM speakers. Hopefully also some of speakers listen to this webinar. And we will meet with case files more often during EFLM webinars. So, Anna, it's my great pleasure to welcome you and to give you words to start your exciting presentation.
Many thanks, Dan, for your nice introduction. And I hope everybody like this clinical case. Let me start saying that this is a clinical case about a patient with shock and multi-organ failure. The patient was a 66-year-old woman. She was admitted to our hospital with shock and multi-organ failure. She was born in India, but she was a resident in the United States in a rural area of New Jersey. It's important to remark that she didn't live in a big city. She was living in a rural area of New Jersey. She had been on vacation in Europe for 3 weeks and had suffered fever and chills for 1 week, nausea, vomiting, and abdominal pain for 2 days. When she was in Finland, she started with fever, but she was to the doctor and antibiotics were prescribed because an urine infection was suspected. So when she arrived to Barcelona 2 days ago, she had fever again, but also nausea, vomiting, and abdominal pain. She had first been admitted to another hospital where blood analysis in the clinical lab showed anemia, low platelet count, low prothrombin index, and high creatinine levels. So if you can see the values of the hemoglobin, the values were low, the platelets also low for the 10 to the 9th, only 56% the prothrombin index. Creatinine was high, was 3 milligrams. Total bilirubin was 10. Most of this bilirubin was indirect bilirubin. And the hepatic transaminases were also increased. So during the next few hours, her clinical condition was going bad and bad. She was transferred to our hospital, to my hospital, Hospital Clinic of Barcelona. On admission, she showed not only respiratory, but also hepatic and renal failure. Anemia, lymphopenia, thrombocytopenia, high lactate dehydrogenase values. You can see here the values, 3,500 units. And negative, direct, and indirect Coombs tests. So the peripheral blood field was very important to get the diagnosis of this patient, because a large number of ring-shaped parasites within the erythrocytes were seen, and these parasites were interpreted as a malaria infection. I will show some images now. I think the images are very representative of the disease. I will explain slowly all the morphological findings in these images. So this is the first image, and we can see some parasites inside the red blood cell here, 1, 2, 3, and 4. Also, we can see some parasites outside the erythrocytes. Here we can see 2, here we can see 1. This is another image. You can see also the low level of platelets, because in this image we are not able to see any platelet. This is because, as I said before, the platelet levels were low. And here we see again some green parasites outside the red cells, but in one of the red cells we can see 1, 2, 3, 4. Look the size of these parasites. The size is slow. They are small, and only 4. Here only 1. Here we have 1. Same images. Extracellular parasites. You can think, people that is listen to me, and if you had the opportunity to see malaria parasites, you can think if they can be outside the red cells when you do the peripheral blood examination or not. So we have here extracellular rings and intracellular. Some more here extracellular. This is a very interesting finding and very representative finding of this pathology. We can see here a red cell with 4 parasites, 1, 2, 3, and 4, and you can see that they are touching each other, and you have the impression that this is like a cross. This cross has a name, but maybe I prefer to say the name afterwards, because there are a question before, and I would like you think about before to say something else about this. Here you have more parasites inside, 1, and here you have 4. Look through the different size of the parasites. You can see here this is bigger and these are smaller. This is another interesting finding in peripheral blood in this infection. You can see 2 neutrophils, and inside the neutrophil, in the cytoplasm of the cell, the white blood cell, you can see some parasites. This is very typical of this kind of infection. Also, we can see some other red cells infected. And I think this is the last one. You have here a big platelet, the red cells, a neutrophil with some parasites inside, and some extracellular rings. Just one comment, that more than 20% of the red cells in the peripheral blood of this patient showed pleomorphic piriform parasites. So, at this point, I would like to ask you the first question of this presentation. What is the morphological diagnosis after the morphological signs that we saw in these images. The answer 1, Plasmodium falciparum. The answer 2, Plasmodium vivax, Plasmodium ovale, or Babebiosis. I think you can answer what is your opinion with respect to the pathology that this patient has. The first impression when these images were seen, I said before that was a malaria, but we'll see. Okay, I think that we can go ahead. More or less, we have 40% of Plasmodium falciparum responses and 60% of babesiosis. Let's go through with the next slide. Red cells contain 2 or more parasites within 1 to 3 small chromatin dots. More findings. The parasites were pleomorphic and sometimes they showed the 4 pointed ends in contact. This is the characteristic Maltese cross formation that is described in the books in this kind of infection. And another finding was that ring forms were seen not only inside the red cells, but also extracellular and, very important, within neutrophils, inside the cytoplasm of the neutrophils. This is the Maltese cross formation that I mentioned before. And you can see here the point end of 4 parasites touching in one point. This is a small picture, and you can see here how the red cells showed peripheral parasites, which size was lower with respect to Plasmodium falciparum trophozoites. Look, especially these forms. These forms are very small with respect to the Plasmodium falciparum trophozoites. And also, we never seen extracellular rings, trophozoites, in Plasmodium falciparum infection. We didn't see any hemosuin pigment inside the neutrophils. In the infection, in the malaria, in the Plasmodium falciparum, especially infection, we used to see when the infection is in a progression form, we can see this pigment. This is the pigment called Maurer pigment. So in this case, in our patient, we didn't see this typical pigment. And also, we saw some parasites within the neutrophils. And this is not seen in the malaria infection. So the absence of this hematological finding and this special finding of parasites inside the neutrophils are very typical in the infection that we are going to talk. All these morphological findings in peripheral blood suggest the diagnosis of babesiosis. In the United States, most of the cases of babesiosis have been because the babesia microti, and most of them are acquired in the northeast of the country. Remember that I told before that this patient was from the eastern part of the United States, close to New York, but in the countryside. And the problem was that she was living in an endemic region, in an endemic country, but the disease started when she was in another country. When she was traveling across Europe. And she had no history of known sick contact, but contact with her was reported. She was living in a rural area, and a lot of these animals were around. I have another question ready for everybody. I encourage people to answer. This is not difficult. Which of the following treatments may be indicated in this patient? Exchange transfusion, quinine, and clindamycin, atovaquone, and azithromycin, or all of these are indicated for the treatment of this kind of infection. Think about that more of 20% of the red cells were infected. It's a lot. It's a situation delicate for the patient. The patient was in shock, and she had a lot of red cells with parasites inside. Hmm? Another thing that you can think is that all these four pharmacologic agents that I put here, all of them are indicated in infections by parasites. Go ahead. You are doing very well, everybody. Very well. Okay. I think we can finish. Most of the participants answered that all of these therapeutic measures were indicated. And it's true, it was true. In this case, more than 20% of the red cells were infected, so it was necessary to do an exchange transfusion. And this is in malaria also, when you have such amount of red cells infected, it's recommended to do this therapeutic measure. Also, quinina and clindamycin are indicated in this infection, but sometimes the complications because of these therapeutic agents, we are obligated to change these pharmacs and to use others, like these other two that are in the list, atovaquone and azithromycin. So the correct response was all of these therapeutic measures may be indicated for the treatment of this infection. So very good, because 70% of the visitors of this webinar said this response. So I explained that the treatment with quinina and clindamycin, both intravenously, was initiated 2 days after her presentation, and also she received a change transfusion, but quinidine and clindamycin were stopped after 2 days because of the neurological deterioration, and at this moment oral atovaquone and intravenous azithromycin were started. How was the evolution of our patient? Let me say that following the change, parasitemia decreased markedly to 0.3%. We need to do some hemodialysis because of the persistence of renal failure. In the next 3 days, the parasitemia decreased further and became negative. And also hepatic, renal, and respiratory function was recovered by our patient. We published this clinical case in a British Journal of Hematology at the beginning of this year. If you look through, you can find this case explained. And also, I put here some, I think, interesting papers about this infection. And I would like to transmit to the people that is hearing this webinar the importance of the peripheral blood examination to the diagnosis, not only in this kind of infections, in other hematological and not hematological disease. In this paper, Barbara Bain is a very famous cytologist. She said that the laboratory hematologist has a very important role in the diagnosis of parasitic infections. And the examination of peripheral blood is very critical in the diagnosis of malaria, babesiosis, filariasis, trypanosomiasis, also bone marrow. But peripheral blood is more easy to obtain. It's a sample very useful and very easy to obtain. There are other signals to think about parasites like eosinophilia or iron deficiency, but I think low values of platelets in a patient that was traveling in the recent days, I think is a very important sign in a patient when come to the emergency hospital. So this is a nice paper if you want to find. This is another review, very interesting, that I recommend people interested in this disease, about human babesiosis. This is New England. I read, and it's really easy to read and very interesting. Another question. Ready? Which of the following findings in peripheral blood can be useful to recognize babesia? Extracellular ring trophocytes, parasites in the neutrophils, pleomorphisms and smaller size of the ring forms together with the absence of hemozoin, or all these important morphological findings are useful in the differentiation of Babesia parasites from Plasmodium falciparum infection? Go ahead, because I think this is not very difficult after this presentation. I hope. Oh, I like to see the results. I like very much to see. Everybody is marking the last one. So I think that this presentation show something to all of you. I think the message of this presentation, so the response is that all of these morphological findings are useful in the differentiation of parasites, Babesia parasites from Plasmodium falciparum infection. Extracellular, parasites in the neutrophils, the different size, and the absence of hemozoin pigment in the case of Babesia. So I have some comments to add. The first comment is that the trophocytes of Babesia are small rings that easily are confused with those of Plasmodium falciparum. If you check in literature, you can see some publications about different cases in which the first impression was that the patient was hit by a Plasmodium falciparum. So all the responses mentioned in the question are useful morphological findings to distinguish Babesias from Plasmodium falciparum parasites. These infections, called tick-borne infections, are seen in the United States in different geographical locations. I mentioned it before that in the eastern part of the United States, infection for the Babesia microti infection is not very unusual. Another thing is some cases have been described also in the Pacific coast and in the north of California and also in the Washington state. Sporadic cases has been described in Kentucky. If we go to another country, if you talk about Europe, in Europe the infection is because of Babesia divergens. This kind of Babesia is not so good. The response of the patients after the treatment is not so good with respect to the Babesia. Also, some sporadic cases has been described in Japan and in Taiwan, in the south of Korea, and some sporadic cases also have been described in Africa, in Australia, in South America. And let me see that this is an emerging health risk in several parts of the world. So we need to think about, because if we think about, we have a patient with this problem, we can get the diagnosis. But if we cannot imagine this diagnosis, is so in this case it's more difficult to be able to help to this patient. Let me say that the human are infected by the bite of the ixodid ticks frequently. The diagnosis in the early infection is a challenge for the professionals, not only for the professionals that are working in the clinical part of the hospital, also in the professionals that we are working in the laboratory, in the clinical laboratory, and we need to be very prepared to be able to do this morphological diagnosis. And also, let me repeat that it's very important, the examination, peripheral blood, in fact, is critical in the diagnosis, and the laboratory hematologist has a role in the diagnosis of parasitic infections. More things that we need to think about, in addition to morphology, and it's very important, adequate clinical history. It's important, especially for speedy and accurate diagnosis. Very particular in non-endemic areas, because if you live in an endemic areas, you are prepared to think about. But if you live in a country where this infection is not an endemic infection, so it's not so probably that you think in this. This infection can be asymptomatic or can result in severe clinical conditions with hemolysis, severe hemolysis, hepatic, and renal failure. And the disease is especially serious in advanced age or in not immunocompetent patients, in splenectomized patients. In such situations, exchange transfusion, in addition to antimicrobial treatment, could be life-saving. Some words about differential diagnosis. In this image, we have some red cells with some parasites. In this case, is malaria, Plasmodium falciparum malaria, because we have some very similar size rings in the same red cell. Here not, here we have only one. If you remember the previous images about Babesia, you remember that the size of the rings, the size was smaller with respect to this. Here we cannot see any trophozoite outside of the red cells. This is a gametocyte of Plasmodium falciparum. Look, this long shape like a banana. And inside you can see the pigment, particularly pigment of the malaria. Now, again, a Plasmodium falciparum infection. We have one red cell with more than one ring. And look that some of the rings have more than one chromatin dot. This is very typical Plasmodium falciparum infection. You cannot see platelets in this picture because in Plasmodium infection, the platelet levels go down. Same in Babesia. Two more gametocytes of Plasmodium falciparum. And this is the Maurer pigment that I mentioned before inside the white blood cells in one case of Plasmodium falciparum infection. You can see also some red cells with trophozoites inside. Again, more Maurer pigment inside the neutrophils, low platelets. And let me, before finish my presentation, show you some nice images about other inclusions in neutrophils. For instance, in this neutrophil, you can see here an inclusion. The name of this inclusion is pseudo-Howell-Jolly inclusion. And These are typical inclusions in patients. They are immunosuppressed patients. Immunosuppressed because of virus infection, cytomegalovirus or HIV virus, or immunosuppressed by other reasons like after a transplant, hematological transplant or solid transplant, renal or hepatic transplant. We can see this kind of inclusions. This is one example of this pseudo-Howell-Jolly inclusion. The name is pseudo-Howell-Jolly because you know that the Howell-Jolly inclusions are typical of red in the red cells in patients that are splenomegalovirus. And here we see these inclusions in a neutrophil. Another kind of inclusions is the typical in the Myhreglin anomaly. We can see these long, elongated inclusions, blue inclusions inside the cytoplasm of the neutrophil. And you can observe not only the inclusion, but also a big platelet. The Myhreglin condition is an inherited low platelet condition. Patients show low platelets, big platelets, very big size, and also this kind of inclusions inside the neutrophils. Very important to realize of these inclusions to think in this disease. And these Myhreglin inclusions are different with respect to the Dole bodies in myelodysplasias. This abnormal accumulation of ribosomes in the cytoplasm of the abnormal neutrophils because of the myelodysplasia. This is another body, Dole, and another kind of inclusions in neutrophils we can see in another disease called Chediak Ihashi. This is an inherited disease, and in this case, the neutrophils have an anomaly in the lysosomes. So the lysosomes are very big, look like this. And you should be able to differentiate these kind of inclusions of the other that I showed before. This is another example of these inclusions, Chediak Ihashi. Other kind of inclusions, cannot forget about these intracellular bacterial infections. This is a clinical case that we published recently in British Journal of Hematology about the presence of Streptococcus calolyticus inside the neutrophils in a patient with endocarditis and brain abscesses. This is not very usual. This is unusual, but we can see in some cases platelets inside the neutrophils, and which is the meaning. We can see platelets inside the neutrophils in asepsis, for instance, or other cases published is in lymphomas, in some lymphomas. And in my hospital, we recently saw one case of platelets inside of the neutrophils in a myelodysplasia. But I have to say that in our case, this phagocytosis of platelets was secondary to the EDTA anticoagulant, because if we took the sample of the patient without any EDTA anticoagulant, we cannot see this phenomenon. This is one picture of this case that I mentioned. We cannot forget about the cryoglobulins inside the neutrophils. You can see these like balls, big balls of different sizes, some of them white color, some of them blue color. We need to do the association of this finding with the cryoglobulins. And we published some years ago one case, one patient with this abnormality that I'm explaining, in a case of monoclonal gammopathy of undetermined significance. And it's spectacular. So if you see this, you can think about. So in conclusion, I think the peripheral blood film review has a big value. It's very important for our patients because complements and validates the findings of the automated hematologic analyzers, and also provides very useful information or hematologic abnormalities that cannot be assessed by the usual hematologic analysis that we have nowadays in our labs. It's very useful to check abnormal red cell morphology, to detect the presence of blast cells, lymphoma, or other abnormal cells, to be able to check the platelet clumping or abnormal morphology of platelets, to be able to detect these hematopoietic signs, and as the case that we presented today, to look and to find out the presence of parasites. And this, as in this case, can be very useful for our patients. I put in the presentation some reference about the importance of peripheral blood morphology and also about the infection, Babesia's infection. And thank you very much for your attention. I hope that you learned something today.
Dr. Merino, thank you very much for this great and interactive presentation. I hope we all have learned something very interesting. Now the presentation is opened for discussion. We have one question from Mr. Walker. Babesiosis is usually a not so severe disease. The course of the disease is mild or milder, and you have mentioned it, Anna. How do you explain that the time course or the course of this woman was so severe, so difficult?
You are right. Usually, this infection, the symptoms are not so important. The patients that are infected and they don't have spleen, so in these patients, the symptoms are more serious. But this patient was immunocompetent. This patient has her spleen in the right place. So it's true that the symptoms in this case are very, very bad. But, you know, it depends of each person has different predisposition to symptomatology. For instance, the Plasmodium falciparum infection, we use to see more and more. And it's true that in some patients, the symptoms are not so dramatic, but in some people, and also in young people, and people with not any other pathologies, and the infection go, and in some cases, patients die. It's true that in Europe, every year, people, through because of the malaria. Probably there are some predisposition, some idiosyncrasy, I'm not sure if the word is correct, to be more or less affected by this kind of infections.
Okay, thank you for the answer. I will continue with another question. There are other questions here. Can a Babesia infection be spontaneously cleared, from Julian Sen?
Sure. Yes. And sometimes it's patient like a big flu and no more. Yes, but in most of the cases they have fever and they have splenomegaly and they have analytical alterations, and the infection is very easy to clean, but in some cases, as the case that I explained it, not was so good. So the response is yes.
Okay, thank you. One question from Irena. Do you perform any additional staining in the case of bacteria in neutrophils, or the Grünwald GIMSA is enough?
In the hematology lab, we only use microbial GEMSA. But when we saw some bacteria in neutrophils, we contact with microbiology department, and they do other studies, of course, but not in the hematology lab.
Is the method of dense drop efficient for detecting of malaria?
Well, I think that yes, the response is yes. And I think that in some labs they prefer Migrum valgensa, and in other labs they prefer the dense drop. Maybe if you use to the Migrum valgensa, you prefer the Migrum valgensa. For instance, for me, it's very, I prefer much more Migrum valgensa. But I know that in the microbiology laboratory, they prefer the dense drop. But I think both are good methods, and some advantage in each of the methods we can find. Both are okay.
Okay, there's another question from Sandra. Do you have any data about the incidence of babesiosis in USA?
Okay, yeah. I can say that the number of cases are increase. It's like the malaria. Malaria is also increasing and increasing. Why this disease is increasing? Which are the reasons that can explain why these infections are increasing? In the case of the babesia, you know that the white tail deer, these kind of animals, are also increasing in the country, especially in rural areas. So if the population of these animals, the white-tailed deers, if you have more animals, you have more reservoir of the infection, and the incidence increase. Another explanation is the people, communities, likes to go to live outside the cities in wildlife regions, and you are more exposed to this infection if you live outside the country in a wildlife region, in a rural area, and with the nice deers around. So these two reasons are explanations. Another thing that I didn't mention that I would like to say something about is that this infection is possible that the transmission of this infection can be because of blood transfusion. So, for instance, there are 150 cases reported because of blood transfusion and infection of babesia. Most of the infections have been because of the microti, babesia microti, and probably the incidence of I am sure that the first case was reported in 1979, the first case of transfusion associated to babesia infection, but from the 1979 to now, 150 cases have been reported, and three of four parts of these infections have been reported after the 2000 year, so relatively frequent in the last years. So I don't know if I respond to the question or not. May you tell me?
Sandra said that your answer was great. It's very nice to have such vivid discussion with a great, great audience. And we have another, maybe last question from Muhammad Abdi. What is the choice test in patients with suspected babesiosis who have negative findings on peripheral smears, e.g. low levels of thrombocytopenia?
Maybe DNA studies or studies more molecular studies, more appropriate done in a microbiology lab. I think in professionals working in a clinical lab, in a general lab, they have to be able to detect in the Migrum valgensa staining. And after that, if not, all the more specific studies should be done in a microbiology lab.
So I think we have had a great discussion, great presentation. So if nobody has no other question, I would like to thank everybody for the participation. I would like to thank Anna Merino for this very instructive presentation. And I'm looking forward to other webinars that will be held in the next year, 2017. You can see some of them here on the slide. And please fill in the feedback form, very easy, very nice feedback form for this presentation to ensure us to be better, to have nicer and nicer webinars for you. Also, if you would have any suggestions, what should be the next topic or next topics for our webinars, please send us the feedback too. So, see you in other occasions, other webinars. Goodbye.
Thank you, Dan. Thank you very much.